point. I was trying to keep it. Chair asked me to be short. I said that's easy. So these are just notes. There's no cricket match. How many of you? I think all of us want to be keen, green, or smart. Unfortunately, a lot of times these end up being buzzwords because I don't think anyone wants to get here about. And so another word that really comes to mind as we talk about conditions is trade-offs. And that's really the key challenge ahead of us, nation, world in fact. So a lot of the points I want to make are public based on studies that we do at Brookings again. To find much more detail and depth from any of the claims or statements I'm going to make. And I'm going to focus on some high level thoughts as opposed to the details or the numbers, which aren't the things. It's not just the costs of this transition that are important, of course, someone's got to pay for any change, but it's really going to be about the limits and uses. And we see that in the coal space, we also have that in the renewable space to some extent. And we're also going to see it hasn't come up enough in the electric vehicle space. And so I'll share a few numbers and thoughts on that. All energy has negative implications. It's not just the air pollution that alone, but even things like land, access rights, and so forth. So the other question that I spent a lot of time thinking about is who are the winners, who are the losers? What are the institutional statement. It's really a systems evolution. You cannot look at just one silo of open universities. I'm very wary of subsidizing the rich. If you look at, for example, 30% capital subsidy for rooftop solar, no points for guessing which segment of residences are the beneficiaries of that. So, and it's the same worry I have now when you look at the massive schemes of rolling out electric vehicle charging systems. Are we subsidizing the rich? Which is one reason I do like the new focus lane 2 has been on public transport, which really is a good beneficiary of public funds for part of this transition. It's a little bit granularity because these average numbers are very misleading. It's that we have differences by decile for the segments of the population, rich versus poor is just part of it. But also, like a good restaurant, the three things that really matter for the success of a restaurant, location, location, location. And so the rules of movement in India are disproportionately based on location. The other transition that is getting up discussion, we talked a lot about RE and coal, there's talk on electric vehicles, is also on changing how we think electricity and energy. A lot more smart. Oh yeah, sorry, I'm using my own buzzword when I said it. But you can translate smart into being more granular, more nimble, and more situationally aware. The old grid, I won't call it the dumb grid. The old grid was how do you make demand? You always want enough supply to meet any eventuality. In the modern system, why not? First of all, the supply itself is going to become more and more uncontrollable. Renewables are by definition variable. Second is, even your demand can be made to match supply instead of the other way around. Transition is something utterly missing. Even though at the NASDAQ level, also need to know more about this. We don't have time of day pricing, for example, for electricity. And I'm not just talking about end user, maybe has it for large consumers over 20 kVA. That's a very small fraction. Even how we buy the bulk of wholesale electricity is tricky. It's like Apple, a commodity, 5 rupees a kilogram, 5 rupees a kilowatt hour. But this basket of fruit that we sell is not an apple. It's a blend of lychees, mangoes, apples, bananas. Different costs, different characteristics, different kind of availability, different impacts, different brand pick. But we blend it and sell it as fruit, 5 rupees a kilo. That's a bad way to run electricity. I'm going to focus on India, even though, of course, pollution is by way of pollution. And here, I'm going to just make some personal observations. India has not been to blame for the carbon crisis globally, and it will not be the world's savior. No matter how heroic India is in its ambitions, its targets, it won't be enough to solve the problem. That is not put the pressure off the best that India can do, but it's not going to be enough. And when I say ambitions, this is part of the difference between Europe and the United States. The West, we're talking about, in general, a couple of percent decarbonization means in 20, 30 years, you can decarbonize. India, the demand is still growing. So you have targets of adding 55% or more than that of renewables and renewables. That is virtually unparalleled. The only country that's achieved similar scale and percent is China, and that has not been a painless transition. Coming to coal and electricity, a few numbers of framing are very, very important. Coal world says, oh, we need to cut down its coal. But sure, to some extent, but let's put this in context. First is, tons of coal, if you normalize it per capita, India's consumption is still half of the world average coal consumption. Second, tons itself is misleading, because our tons, on average, have much less energy content than carbon content. So-called lower quality, we all know it's about high acids. It's its own separate problem from a pollution perspective. So right there, if you want to be fair, you want to knock off 20 plus 25% in improvement. And then I already mentioned this issue of labor and growth. Because in India, much of our emissions are electricity, and much of our electricity is coal. When other countries are phasing out coal, like the U.S. has already cut its coal emissions, that was because they now cheap gas, shale. But even if you get electricity to clean up in the West, you still have a huge amount of natural gas getting consumed. We don't have a heating load like we do in the West, and even our transport consumption of fossil fuels is relatively low compared to a bunch of other countries. So just focus on coal. It's important for India because that's where the emissions are, but the burden of our media will become disproportionate if we go for the larger greenhouse gas emissions. There's a lot of analysis talking about this transition of RE. We don't foresee equal for the electricity sector through 2030 under most scenarios of high RE. This is very important. Everyone says coal is dead. We would like to be different. What is likely to happen is a dramatic slowdown in the growth rates of coal in the short term, medium term, and not a debt of coal. I know a lot of people, mentioned, hey, it's too expensive. Problem is, all of these capital emissions thus far are on what we would call the low-hanging fruit of variable RE. Which means take it when you can. When the sun shines, you take it. When the wind blows, you take it. Our winter season, we have the data. We just launched a week ago. First, mean real-time tracker of generation by site, 5 minute granularity. So, anyone is now welcome to carbontracker.in. It's a new tool to be available to your alert that you can get. And now you can see that in the season, RE is kind of here. So the graph is on Germany's mid-day summer and demand happily coincide. But in India, if you remove the RE, you now start to ask what is your net demand. Which means after taking out RE, treating renewables as negative demand, not as supply, then your peaks are in the evening. And that is unfortunately the near term. All these discussions about shifting agricultural food is okay, but two problems. One, it doesn't change your eating too much. There's another paper on our website that explains how some states have already done it entirely. Karnataka, because it's moving at a feeder level, has already done what many other states are talking about for food and agriculture. The eating virtually stays the same. Because you're not supplying agriculture, electricity during the
immunity periods. In general, there's no exceptions. Second problem, it's a systems evaluation. Go back to the very nice version. Free electricity. Free power. Nobody said electricity is free from solar. But it is free at the margin. RE is a capital expenditure bill. Once you build the solar pumps, it's free to operate. And so now we have unlimited energy available. Or at least similar free electricity at certain times of the day. The power of the solar pump. I'm going to use water in this building. Of course, it's. And where do I use it? I actually, many farmers in the form of others have water in the group. Otherwise. And so, we run, or risk running out of water before we risk running out of energy. So, the whole carrot of RE impact is not the average cost, which are the numbers that you show, but it's really having the right electricity. Any electricity at the right time, and that's where today RE doesn't have enough ability. Good news, there's a lot more capability of RE to grow before we reach fundamental bottlenecks. But the bad news is that that's only a couple of years away. Our surplus in the electricity grid, in a separate paper going on in the is only going to last us a couple of years. And one of the key elements for that question is, what are we doing about cleaning up our coal? So once we recognize that coal is going to die, we need to clean it up. And this is where it's sad that what was a very aggressive, some would say overly aggressive time schedule, the pendulum has swung too far, and now it's 5 years before we actually get to clean up. Why do we use it 5 years? Well, we can do it before the coal power plant is made. No. But the entire government plan is terrible. So they're not doing anything in the next 2 years or not enough. And everything happened in the last 1 to 2 years. Well, that's when your surplus of today has already disappeared. And that's a very big problem. So we need to rethink how we incentivize, how we regulate, and how we force the state. I won't talk about these as much since the shortened time. Except leave you with one question. Let's not talk about charging infrastructure. Let's just talk about what powers of electric vehicles. And the swing producer in India is coal. It's gas in a bunch of countries. It's not hydro. Hydro is very easy to turn on and off. Hydro is fulfilling other requirements, equal balancer, or in this particular season, hydro is de facto must run. But when you say let's switch off the hydro and make it match RE, we can do so more. We cannot do it all the way. Hydro is today a must run based on monsoon, snow melt, and a bunch of other factors. So, coal is what runs at now. When are most people who are plugging in electric vehicles? Coal now. Because that's the cheapest. Because you can slow charge it. I don't see too many homeowners who 10, 20, 50 kilowatt fast chargers. It's not expensive. Other than a niche SRM that you don't want. Yes. The first users, buses, owners, of course, they're mobile in much of the day. You may get an hour break in the middle of the day. It's like, why do you design your system with something that doesn't match your use cases? And so the swing producer, unfortunately, remains coal. In short, we will not. Now, battery costs are falling. Renewables will make more and more batteries, but they're still rather expensive in the Indian use cases, Indian scenario, with Indian costs are falling. So, we have to be realistic in how we regulate, whether it's pollution, whether it's incentives of pricing. And good news is, I think innovation has a fair amount of space to play. But we have to set up the prices in ways like, whether it's pollution, whether it's grid congestion, time of day, we shouldn't be picking technology rules. So, for example, why don't we have, to ensure green as well, more hybrid electric vehicles? For certain use cases, it's superior to electric vehicles. But we have policy distortions that people want to talk to. I'm not pro or anti any technology. We should have policy that's agnostic and enables all of the above. And so this really comes back to the starting thing is this transition that's ahead of us is really about managing the movement of users. If somebody says, is your solution solar? Is your solution battery? Is your solution smart grid? Is your solution X? The answer is all of the above. We're not going to find any one of these to meet neither the energy requirements nor how to clean it up. We need all levers as fast as reasonably possible. And that's where I think there's a lot of potential for a lot of innovation and a lot of shifts in the coming years. Thank you.